You're listening to an Airwave Media Podcast.
Recorded in Chicago, Illinois, with your hosts, Ken, Matt, Neil, and Jeff, this is Triviality.
Hello and welcome to Triviality, the game where a lack of seriousness meets a little bit of knowledge. My name is Neil, here with Jeff and Ken. How are you both today?
I'm good.
Doing okay.
My heart goes out to those at Riot Fest today, including Matt.
Yep, Matt's over there.
It's pouring. It is going to be muddy.
I forgot about that.
So enjoy the mud pit.
Who's the main headliner today that's going to be in the rain? You don't know? Yeah, Matt's just going to be soaked, though. We know that for sure.
That's true.
Hopefully he'll have a good time, though.
I imagine him like a wet cat.
Yeah, yeah, I can see that. I don't think he's going to be happy about being soaked, that's for sure.
He's gonna get a full beauty treatment because he'll just be covered in mud.
All of his eyeliner is gonna drip off, and he's going to be back to normal Matt, not emo Matt. But
so, yeah, we're vindicated.
Yeah, that's true. Vindicated. But yeah, Jeff, how are you doing today?
I'm doing fine. Happy to be in the dry. I forgot about Riot Fest when I was coming over here and being a baby with my umbrella, even though it's only like drizzling now. But
we truly are old.
Before we get started, I guess I just wanted to do one more giveaway for the Christmas trivia book, if you guys don't mind.
I don't.
You don't mind. So I asked a question the last two times. All we're looking for is just send an email with the answer. If you get it correctly, and there's more than the allotted books that I have on my person, I will do a little raffle system. But the question today to win a signed copy of the Christmas movie Ultimate Trivia Book is, who is the only actor to win an Oscar for playing Santa Claus? Mm-hmm. So if you can email us the answer to that question at trivialitypodcast@gmail.com, only actor to win an Oscar for playing Santa Claus, you will get a signed copy sent to you.
I think I know it. Is it...
David Harbour.
Is it that one?
It is that one.
I'll bleep it.
Oh, that's fine.
I knew it.
Yep.
I don't know the guy's name, though.
Yeah, Ken knew it. Jeff, you guessed David Harbour from Violent Night. Maybe for a sequel one day, which is a great movie. And it's in the book. There's questions about Violent Night. But we have not a Violent Night today. We have a celebration with some great guests, and we're excited to introduce them. Let's start with our host today. So excited to have him here. He's an Oakland 5 supporter on Patreon, coming to us from Tallahassee. David Siekbert, Jr. How are you, David?
Hey, doing well. How are y'all doing?
So, David, tell us a little bit about yourself. We're so happy to have you here today.
Yeah, I'm from Tallahassee, Florida. I originally was from Jacksonville. Moved here to go to college. I expected to move at some point, haven't after I graduated FSU. I've been listening since 2020, and then recently decided, hey, you know, might as well pay $5 to support what you guys are doing. And yes, it only cost me, you know, one cup of coffee from the conglomerate, but I think it's well worth it.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
We appreciate that.
Thank you for saying that. We see that you're in full Eagles regalia here. You're a big Philadelphia Eagles fan.
Yeah, I got family from up there. After what happened in Atlanta, against Atlanta, it was a little salty, but you know, hopefully against the Saints today, they'll do a little bit better. But I guess I'll see you at halftime after this recording's over.
Well, we are certainly giving you our best thoughts, and maybe one of us, maybe Matt, will dress up as Green Man and come help support you and the team. Sure. But thanks for being here. Our next guests, we're super excited to have. They run a great trivia podcast, one that I've had the pleasure of being on, and hopefully some of the other guys here will get a chance to be on as well. But they also have their own conglomerate as well, which is super fun. But I want to introduce both of them at the same time. We got John Speas from Las Vegas and Adam Speas from Atlanta. How are you both today?
I take offense. You said we have a great trivia podcast. We have a trivia podcast. I'll tell you that. doing good. I'm Adam from LaGrange, which is about an hour south of Atlanta. And I'm excited to be here to show you my mediocre trivia skills. I'm a decent host, mediocre player. That's what I say.
And John, how about you?
Yeah, I'm John from Las Vegas. I echo what Adam said. One of the reasons we got into hosting is because we enjoy trivia, but we're pretty mid at it. So we figured we'd make better hosts than we would players.
We're the Philadelphia Eagles of trivia players.
Ooh.
So mid.
Laying down the gauntlet.
I'm sorry. I'm going to do a little dirty bird for you. Go Falcons. Go Falcons.
Adam's got the Kohl's cash. He's ready to make it rain. Well, both of you, you have Throwback Trivia Takedown, which is an awesome podcast. I even though I know you said, you know, it's not a great trivia podcast, I think so, and it was fun beyond. But if folks don't know about it, what is the Throwback Trivia Takedown podcast, and what do you guys have cooking coming up soon?
All right, so we are, it's a very simple premise of the podcast. It's all about nostalgia. We have a podcast network called the Blast From Our Past Network. Pretty much every podcast on there has something to do with nostalgia, or usually something from our childhood. And it's three rounds. The first two rounds are 10 questions each. We have the same 10 categories every time. So the categories never change. But every time you pick a category, you have to, one of us rolls to find out what decade that question is going to be based in. It can be anywhere from the 50s all the way up to the 2000s. So there's a huge breadth of knowledge you kind of have to have. Most of it is, well, I would say almost all of it is pretty much pop culture centered. And then the third round is kind of like Jeopardy. Everyone picks, or you pick two questions. You have to get those right to get your points and in bid and stuff like that. But it's a fun trip down memory lane for a lot of people.
Yeah, and it's fun. I think, Ken, I think you'd enjoy it if it's right up your alley. You got the rolling aspect because you love rolling dice.
I do love it.
Jeff also loves to roll dice in his spare time. But do you have a tournament coming up? Is that right?
Yeah. So each year we throw our tournament of for all of our patrons. So you have to be at the $5 or more level. It's something that we've been doing for the past 4 years, and we love it. It's a lot of fun. We kind of have to do some play-in rounds that we do for our exclusive Patreon exclusive feed. And then during kind of to tie in with March Madness, we'll do our tournament each year. But you have to be in by the end of this year as our patron before you can kind of move on and kind of be put into the play-in rounds and get started on that. But it's a lot of fun. We've had some incredible players win our tournaments, and so far four different champions, and so we might even have a little mini tournament just to and we'll probably actually, when this comes out, we might be in the middle of that. So but yeah, it's a fun time. All the patrons seem to really enjoy it, and it adds a lot of, I would say, competitiveness amongst our, I mean, you guys know trivia people are competitive. We all want to win, so it's a lot of fun.
Well, speaking of competition, both of you are going to be playing today to face off against Jeff and Ken, and you had a pretty fun team name, so what are you going to go by today?
We are going to be Big Speas Energy.
All right.
The Speas Brothers.
Yep.
Sounds like a tag team.
It does. Yeah, I'm curious what they're... You have to figure out what your finishing move is.
The Speas Brothers.
And we're both pretty big boys. That makes sense.
Well, facing off against the Speas Brothers, Big Speas Energy, me and Jeff, we went to see Batman Forever at the theater yesterday.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
And so we're going to be Val Kilmer's Batnips.
There you go. Val Kilmer's Batnips versus Big Speas Energy. We got David holding the reins and hosting today's game. David, any preference on the host read?
Ooh, I think Patrick Warburton has a new movie to come out with Dylan Sprouse soon, so how about we go on to Patrick Warburton?
All right, let's hear from him.
Rules of the game are simple. 20 questions split into two rounds, worth 10 points apiece. At halftime, there will be a special swing round designed by this week's host. After regulation, players will enter the final round with the points that they've accumulated. Have a chance to wager 0 to 30 points in 5 categorized questions. End of the game, someone will be named the cream of the crop. Oh yeah, it's all coming together.
You're the cream of the crop.
Very nice, very nice. All right, well, David, take it away. I'm just going to keep score over here. Feel free to take away, fellas.
Yeah, all right, so I tried to make it as non-pop culture trivia as possible. I guess some of it snuck in there when I was doing play testing. But there is a bonus 5 points. It is a connection. Both rounds are connections, just meaning that all the answers have some sort of connection within them. So after we get through all of those, question, I guess, 11 unofficially will be a connection worth 5 points. All right, so question number one. Category is going to be video game songs. Known as one of the hardest songs in Guitar Hero history, what 2005 song by a very popular British heavy metal band is unlocked after beating the career mode on any difficulty in Guitar Hero 3?
All right, we're locked in.
I think it is this specific. I mean, so great, fantastic. They are known for kind of their quick playing. I actually listen to them when I do squats, when I'm in the gym.
That's the way to do really it. Kinda, you got to find the power up, from somewhere, you know?
Because exactly, you have to, when you're blasting 315 for reps, you have to push it through the fire and through the flames. Mm-hmm. I think this is Through the Fire and Flames by Dragon Force. Yeah. John, any challenge on that?
Nope. Sounds good. Okay.
When you're listening, it's hard not to make the shape of an orb with your hand and just do the stank face. So, yeah, we said Through the Fire and the Flames.
My gym routine is only Operation Ground and Pound. I see. So.
Yeah, I think answer there, Through the Fire and Flames. Yes, question number two. Disney characters is the category for this one. Though not mentioned in the movies, in a canonical book, what Disney character's first name turns out to be Montgomery, which is far less flashy than the name he goes by.
All right, well, we really don't know here. We're going to say the Beast from Beauty and the Beast first name was Montgomery, and it's Montgomery Beast.
Montgomery Beast. That sounds like a good law firm.
Talking about Adam?
Hmm?
Talking about Adam?
Is that his name? Adam C. Beast?
Yeah. Adam Montgomery
Beast. All
Adams
are beasts.
Yeah, we had no real idea either. So the only thing I could think of that had anything had to do with flashing and light, so we said Buzz Lightyear.
Yeah, so no points got to this one. Close. Flashy was the key there, but it's actually Lightning McQueen. His real first name is Montgomery.
Wow.
Oh, I would have never gotten that, so.
I am also just fascinated by the fact that Belle was fully prepared to go all the way, not knowing that he would turn into a man.
Well, if you want to get a wow out of Lightning McQueen, you just got to make sure you find the solenoids. You know what I'm saying, Jeff?
I don't. But good for you.
I guess question number three. We go college sports. I don't have a lot of sports trivia in here because I know that's not many people's cups of tea. But number three is, although a powerhouse in the 80s and 90s, which college football team, along with Boston College, Syracuse, and Louisville, or Louisville, if you're from there, has never won an Atlantic Coastal Conference title? Granted, their name would be different if they were in the Pacific Athletic Conference.
All right, well, this is not our bag, per se, so we're taking a guess, and it's going to be a bad one.
Yeah, John, you just want to get, we can go with Florida Atlantic.
Let's go with Florida Atlantic.
All right.
It's a guess.
All right. Florida Atlantic.
All right. We're giving a salute to Michael Jordan, and we're just going to say Tar Heels, North Carolina.
So again, I guess no points on this one. I didn't mean to trick y'all if you're thinking more of the where they're from. I was looking for the team nickname. This one is the Miami Hurricanes, who would be the Typhoons if they're in the Pacific Conference instead. And also, I would like to talk trash about them right now, but my alma mater, FSU, is right now 1-3, so I can't really do anything right now.
You have to just bank it for later, that's all.
Oh, yeah, I've been banking. I gave money to that school to have 4 bad years of college football for them to be good as soon as I graduate, and then now they stink again, so here we are.
More video games and heavy metal, please.
Yeah. Well, hopefully number 4 is a little bit better. I know it's only September, but I have Christmas movie quotes is going to be this next one. So on the movie Elf, which group of people, which are a fictional task force based on a real-life task force, did Santa say, "I put them on the naughty list and they never forgave me"? It's still unknown if they are under investigation from their actions during the 1985 Simon Garfunkel concert in Central Park.
All right, we're going to lock in. It's been a long time since I've seen Elf, but taking a guess.
We're going to go with maybe. So there is like the task force. There is the Army has the U.S. Army Rangers. Let's go with the Rangers.
Okay. We are going to say, you know, the Hells Angels, known for doing security at concerts occasionally and it being a disaster. So we're going to say the Hex Angels.
Yeah, so actually the answer is the Central Park Rangers. That's the fictional task force from the movie. I'm okay with awarding points to just Rangers, not being Central Park, since I mentioned Central Park in the question. That's completely up to you guys, but I would give points to that.
Yeah, that's
but yeah, fine. The Rangers.
We'll take them.
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure if this is a real thing that happened. I think it's just a quote from the movie, as they said they're still under investigation for the Simon and Garfunkel concert. When I was reading through on the question, I believe there was some sort of incident that a task force that had to deal with the concert in like 1981 for Simon and Garfunkel. There was a riot, but I think this was just some throwaway quote that was just from the movie.
Okay, so you're picking up points there.
Yeah. Take everything I can get or that we can get.
That's a good pull. Yeah, question number five. It's going to be in the category of engineering. On August 27th, 1939, the Heinkel He 178 took flights. This was developed by German physicist Hans von Ohain, and this craft is significant because it's the first to be what?
Yeah. Can we get lock in?
Okay.
The first to be what?
Oh, that's well, confusing. All right. So we know we already had prop planes by then.
Uh-huh.
Do you think maybe this is the first jet?
Like a yeah, jet propulsion?
Like jet propulsion?
That's possible. Screw it. Let's do it.
All right. We'll go with jets.
Yeah, I know they, I think they also experimented with like rocket propulsion at that time, but we're going to guess jet powered.
Yeah. So points to both teams here. Yeah. Powered by jets, jet powered. And that was the answer I was looking for.
After five questions, looks like Val Kilmer's bat nips, given 10 points for each nip. So they have 20 points. And Big Speas Energy bringing 30 points. So very close.
Question number six is in the category of novels. What children's book by Richard and Florence Atwater became a movie in 2011? And unfortunately, no, Danny DeVito did not play any of the characters.
We are locked in on this one, so you guys can feel free to discuss.
Well, we certainly know a word that's in it with Danny DeVito. It certainly makes me think of some of his iconic characters, one of them being the Penguin. Was March of the Penguins?
No, that was a documentary. What about Happy Feet?
I mean, that's possible. It doesn't fit the theme that we're trying to stick with.
Well,
oh, you got it. You guys are on the theme. We got it too, so...
Yeah, it's the only reason that we pulled out that...
We won't reveal it yet.
Yeah. It's the only reason we were able to pull out that one answer.
I see.
I got nothing, Adam. All right, other than, I mean...
I know Happy Feet makes sense. We're just going to go with March of the Penguins because at least has the word penguins in there.
Okay.
Okay. We are settling on Mr. Popper's Penguins.
Yeah.
Points to one team there. Mr. Popper's Penguins. I guess when the movies came out in 2011, I'd have been 13 years old. Didn't like the movie then, and I don't think I'd like the movie now. So,
great clue.
Big Danny DeVito fan here. Obviously, Always Sunny in Philadelphia. Got that. But one of my favorite movies is a movie I really can't name on here because I've been hearing one of those banned questions with Space Jam. no, but on to number seven. This category is going to be pop songs. What One Republic song was released in the summer of 2013? It reached number two on the Billboard charts, but doing this would be hard given there are 9,096 visible ones.
All right, we are locked in.
Yeah. All right, John.
I'm trying
John,
to.
He's tied into the stars. I like stars, and I think they had a. Did they have the song called Counting Stars? There is a song called Counting Stars that is fairly was a pop song.
Okay, then let's go with that one. All right. That fits everything. So
yeah, Counting Stars.
Yep, I wrote down Stars, and Jeff filled in the Counting Stars.
Yeah, and we're going to be counting points for both teams in that one. The answer is Counting Stars.
Yeah, Ryan Tedder was losing sleep and wrote the lyrics.
Neil, you light up my life like nobody else.
Well, thanks, Jeff.
On the question number eight, we have restaurant chains. What sports bar was opened up in 1982 in Columbus, Ohio, but they are more known for allegedly finding ways to make your games longer?
I use this fact all the time, and no one knows what I'm talking about because they don't watch where this may have come from. This.
All right, we're making the call.
Yeah, you're making the call.
And we're locking in.
Yeah, Adam, I think you're dead on.
Yep. All right. Well, yeah. Then... You know, I do enjoy that place. They have they serve apparently more draft beer than any other restaurant. We're going to go with Buffalo Wild Wings.
Yes.
Or by its original names, Buffalo Wild Wings and Weck.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Wex, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whatever that means. Yeah, we are. Okay.
It's a sandwich. Delicious. Beef on Weck.
We are locked in also with Buffalo Wild Wings.
Yep. Both teams getting points there again. Buffalo Wild Wings, one of my favorite restaurants. I have done the Blazing Wing Challenge more times than I want to agree to have said I've been doing. Doesn't really help you at all. Like they give you a T-shirt for like the next day to be like the worst bathroom day of your life. But for some reason,
hot in, hot out.
Yeah, exactly. No, but yeah, both teams, Buffalo Wild Wings.
Your boy Jason Kelsey's in the Buffalo Wild Wings commercials now.
Yeah, I think I cried along too when he retired too, which really shows you where my head was at when he retired, and also Fletcher Cox. But yeah, go on to number nine. That category is just going to be toys. Founded in 1917 and based in Chicago, Illinois, what American toy company made scooters, bikes, trikes, horses, and more notably wagons?
Jeff is a big lover of wagons, so they're locked in here.
I mean, I know it because we've definitely played with those wagons, and I also know it because my favorite hockey team, I have a couple jerseys hanging up there. And
what's this about hockey teams? I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm so sorry.
No, that's okay.
I'm terrible about spoiling this.
I'm sure the listeners have caught on. That
I'm absolutely terrible about spoiling. I don't even think. This has got to be Radio Flyer.
Yep, we also said Radio Flyer.
Yeah, Radio Flyer is the correct answer. Both teams get it correct. I'm also a Flyers fan, sticking with all the Philadelphia teams up there. Hopefully, at some point, they'll be good. But
may have to wait for a while.
I'm sure your Blackhawks fans remember beating us in the Stanley Cup Finals. So,
yeah,
I remember.
Oh yeah,
I used to watch the kids movie Radio Flyer in 1992 with Elijah Wood and Tom Hanks. Mm-hmm.
That's right. It's a good movie.
That's a weird fact just to have off the top of your head.
I would have known that fact. The movie came out 6 years before I was born, so I don't think I've ever seen that before.
Now you can watch it while wearing your Flyers jersey, even though it has no connection, but you can make one.
Now Neil was more than 6 years old when that movie came out.
I was seven. I was seven. That's right.
Oh, I didn't want to give it away.
I was 11, so.
All right, well, on to question number 10 in the category of bands. The platinum single Check Yes Juliet was sung by which band, who got their band name not from being related to royalty, but from the middle school they attended?
All right, so we had the keyword, so to speak. It took us a little while to come around to the right band, but I think we got it.
All right, we're not super confident. The keyword we feel pretty good on as well. But maybe, John, you think these guys might have gone to Leon High School?
I mean, maybe.
Or middle school, whatever it is. Yeah.
I cannot think of any other name. So.
All right. Well, then we're just going to go with Kings of Leon.
Yeah, we thought about Kings of Leon. Jeff informed me that it was pop punk sort of vibe, and that's not really Kings of Leon's forte. And then I thought of...
No, their forte is Sex on Fire.
That's right.
We thought of...
That's called Gunner's Kings.
We the Kings.
Yeah, answer there.
I've never heard of that band, so I don't feel bad.
Yeah, I don't feel bad in listening to that one.
Yeah, answer is We the Kings. They went to Martha B. King Middle School, and that's where they ended up getting their name from.
And on to the bonus here. What links all these questions together? I think
I wonder.
Almost everybody's figured it out. NHL hockey teams.
Yeah, we also said NHL hockey teams.
Yep, yeah, all of them related to NHL hockey teams. I've been trying to get more into hockey as I've been getting older. I think when I was little, I grew up in Florida. Hockey wasn't a big thing, but as I started, you know, getting older, wanting to get into more sports, I've been really getting into hockey, trying to figure out why the Flyers are bad, I guess.
are the Florida teams doing okay?
I wonder.
Florida teams are doing okay.
Yeah, it's odd how the Florida teams are doing so well. Like, you wouldn't think, like, Tampa Bay and the Panthers have been doing really well, and for some reason, you know, you wouldn't think Florida would be such a big hockey town or hockey state.
As David said, Florida teams have been doing really good, and both teams in this game started out a little rough, but they're doing good now. So after 10 questions, it looks like Big Spee's energy is at 65 points, and only 10 points ahead is Val Kilmer's Bat Nips with 75. So as we like to say, it is anyone's game. Before we get to the swing round that David has provided for us today, just wanted to remind you, as he mentioned early on in the episode, for as little as $5 a month, a cup of coffee at the conglomerate, you can join us on Patreon at patreon.com/trivialitypodcast. And Ken, I know you love doing all of the bonus episodes over there.
I do. I enjoy writing these sort of little shorter games that we can all play together. Those come out weekly. I enjoy doing our Ask Me Anything style crop drops. Mm-hmm. They're a lot of fun. Feel free to drop us some questions on the crop or in the Discord or on Patreon if you sign up. But yeah, all that becomes accessible to you if you sign up. And it's so important to us that we increase our Patreon numbers. And we really appreciate those who decide to join us on Patreon. It keeps the podcast going. It gives us the time to provide more content. And the more Patreon supporters we have, the more content that we can create for you guys. So please do consider joining us over on Patreon for as little as $1.
David, what do you have in store for us today?
Yeah, so my swing round is just going to be a pretty basic movie before and after. Obviously, in the before and after, I'm going to mash up the plots of two movies, and you must make a title that fits the before and after theme for that. All right, number one. After a virus turns most living creatures into zombies, Littlefoot, Sarah, Spike, and Ducky must search for the Great Valley and possibly Twinkies. Number two. Texas dishwasher Joe Buck quits his job and heads for New York City. However, he wakes up and finds a metal shackle on his wrist and then helps the town of Absolution against extraterrestrial forces. Number three. Santa, Easter Bunny, the Tooth Fairy, and Jack Frost team up to stop Ronin from destroying planets with the power found inside of an orb. Number four. Troy is sent to live with his father, Furious Styles, in a world where fairy tales are real. Chaos ensues, and Trey, Doughboy, and Ricky must find out who the Goody Bandit is, stealing all the recipes from the fairy tale creatures. Number five. Flick is an inventor who is always messing things up. His latest mishap was destroying a freighter ship containing zoo animals and killing his family. Flick finds a lifeboat and realizes his mishap has made him the only survivor. Well, besides a Bengal tiger, that is. Number six. An orphaned mouse is adopted and proceeds to work at Mushnick's flower shop, where he purchases a flower that survives on human blood. Number seven. Ad executive Roger O. Thornhill is pursued by a spy named Philip Van Damme in New York City after he mistakes him for a government agent. He then finds himself in the middle of a gang war between the Jets and the Sharks. Number eight. In this sports mashup, Jake LaMotta is a great middleweight boxer, but he for some reason decides to stop boxing to go play minor league baseball in North Carolina. Number nine. Jim Carrey stars as an orphan teenage high schooler from Queens who is balancing his life between fighting crime and being a struggling performer whose act fails in nightclubs due to not telling conventional jokes. Number 10. A small town in Texas obsesses over their high school football team. After receiving a fortune cookie, star running back Boobie Miles and coach Gary Gaines switch bodies, where they develop respect for each other and in the other members of the team.
All right, we have all the questions, and we'll be back with these mashups.
With New Year's fast approaching, it's time to get those resolutions in order. My resolution? Well, it starts with this and ends with me speaking a new language. It's Babbel. Speak like a whole new you with Babbel, the language learning app that gets you talking. With quick 10-minute lessons handcrafted by over 200 language experts, Babbel gets you talking a new language in 3 weeks. When I was in college, I tried learning Italian. It didn't go well. Part of the reason was I was making short films for class, but the other reason is I was learning from a book. I was one of 30 students, not getting the right amount of attention that I needed to learn a language like Italian, which can be difficult for people who've never spoken another language. But thankfully, for Babbel, it's worked for millions of language learners of all ages. Learn everything you need from vocabulary to culture while holding your own in conversation with anybody. With Babbel, it just takes 10 minutes a day. You don't need a full semester like I did in college. Here's a special holiday deal for all of our listeners. Right now, get up to 60% off your Babbel subscription, but only for our listeners at babbel.com/social hour. Get up to 60% off at babbel.com/social hour, spelled BABBEL.com/social hour. Rules and restrictions may apply.
Most tax pros leave a message.
It's Jane. I'm moving on to a TurboTax expert who beat your price. Adam Devine, tell him how I feel.
Hey, tax pro, she's been thinking twice. Best believe TurboTax will beat your price.
This is a tax break. Switch to a TurboTax Live expert and we'll beat what you paid your pro last tax season. Make the switch at TurboTax.com/beatyourprice. TurboTax full service only. Sign up by 12/20/2024 and file by 4/1/2025. Full details at TurboTax.com/beatyourprice.
The time for holiday hosting is upon us, so make your second bathroom second to none with HomeDepot.com's best savings of the season. Right now, enjoy up to 40% off select online bath. Find the latest on-trend styles of vanities, faucets, showers, tubs, toilets, and more, all at prices that will let your budget relax right along with you and your beautifully renovated bath. Get up to 40% off select online bath plus free delivery at the Home Depot. Subject to availability, see HomeDepot.com/delivery for details.
We are back with all of the answers locked in. And David, thank you once again for these awesome clues. Let's hear them one more time, and both teams will see how they did.
So, number one, after a virus turns most living creatures into zombies, Littlefoot, Sarah, Spike, and Ducky must search for the Great Valley and possibly Twinkies.
We're going to go with Zombieland Before Time.
And we are going to go with Zombieland Before Time.
Points to both teams. An interesting movie if that ever became a thing, but Zombieland Before Time is correct.
As long as there's 17 of them.
If they made Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies, then we can get a Zombieland Before Time. I mean, number two, Texas dishwasher Joe Buck quits his job and heads for New York City. However, he wakes up and finds a metal shackle on his wrist and then helps the town of Absolution against extraterrestrial forces.
Hey, I'm podcasting here. We said Midnight Cowboys and Aliens.
Yep. I wasn't for sure, but the New York City clue led me to Midnight Cowboys and Aliens.
And that is correct. Yes, Midnight Cowboys and Aliens is the answer for number two. All right, number three. We had Santa, Easter Bunny, the Tooth Fairy, and Jack Frost team up to stop Ronin from destroying planets with the power found inside of an orb.
All right, we know for sure the second part is Guardians of the Galaxy. I think the other one is called The Legend of the Guardians. So we said The Legend of the Guardians of the Galaxy.
I remember seeing this movie with my kids, and I could not, and I know Guardians was in the title, and I could not remember what the rest of the title was. And I thought it was just called The Guardians, so we thought it might be a trick. So we just called it The Guardians of the Galaxy.
Should have been thinking about yeast, gentlemen.
Yeah, that's correct.
Rise of the Guardians?
Rise of the Guardians of the Galaxy. No points there.
Oh.
Now, the Owl movie, I don't feel bad about you guys now. Are thinking of. There's an Owl movie that's called...
Guardians of Gahool!
Either the Legends of the Guardians or the Guardians, and I always, as a kid, mixed those two movies up as well. So
what a mess.
Yeah.
Number four, Trey is sent to live with his father, Furious Styles, in a world where fairy tales are real. Chaos ensues, and Trey, Doughboy, and Ricky must find out who the Goody Bandit is, stealing all the recipes from the fairy tale characters.
So this one was really tripping us up, mostly from the exclamation mark. And we said Boys in the Hoodwinked.
That sounds really good, honestly. But we had absolutely no clue on this one. And it makes sense if that's it, because we've not seen Boys. I don't think either of us have seen Boys in the Hood or Hoodwinked.
Or Hoodwinked.
Yeah. So I have no idea, John. What do you want? What's a good... Well, you're the funny man.
You're the funny man. Make it funny.
I think they went with Dennis the Menace to Society.
Yeah, there you go. That sounds good.
Sure.
Yeah, points go in the one team. Boys in the Hoodwinked is the answer. Didn't mean for this to happen, but all the way back around, Patrick Warburton also in that movie.
There you go. Hoodwinked. Yeah.
More so?
Yeah, that's right.
I forgot about Patrick Warburton and Boys in the Hood.
Yeah, that's where the introduction of Putty came from, was Boys in the Hood. They went to go buy a car. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's right.
Number five. Flick is an inventor who is always messing things up. His latest mishap was destroying a freighter ship containing zoo animals and killing his family. Flick finds a lifeboat and realizes his mishap has made him the only survivor. Well, besides a Bengal tiger, that is.
At least he never sold his kin out to the grasshoppers. We said A Bug's Life of Pi.
We also went with A Bug's Life of Pi.
Points to both teams there. The answer is A Bug's Life of Pi. Number six. An orphaned mouse is adopted and then proceeds to work at Mushnick's flower shop, where he purchases a flower that survives on human blood.
We said Stuart, Little Shop of Horrors.
It's gotta be Stuart, Little Shop of Horrors.
And it is Stuart, Little Shop of Horrors. I, for some reason, have an unnecessary dislike of the concept of Stuart Little. I just can't imagine a world where an orphan for like 5 or 10 years who's been in the New York City system, a family comes in, decides to pick a mouse over them. I just can't imagine how detrimental that would be to any child's development, realizing that a mouse was chosen over them.
If I was an orphan, though, and there was a very intelligent talking mouse that sounded like Michael J. Fox, I'd have to be like, it's fine, I get it.
I mean, but also, yeah. Like, have you seen the cost of living in New York City? Mm-hmm. Obviously, they went with the mouse.
Yeah, you barely have to feed it.
Stuart Little, written by M. Night Shyamalan.
It's true.
Yeah.
Number 7, we have ad executive Roger O. Thornhill is pursued by a spy named Philip Van Damme in New York City after he mistakes him for a government agent. He then finds himself in the middle of a gang war between the Jets and the Sharks.
We said North by North, West Side Story.
We could not come up with the ad agency thing. So we couldn't really come up with anything. So I jokingly said, West Side Story of a Girl.
Yeah, points to one team here. It is North by Northwest Side Story. Number 8 in this sports mashup. Jake LaMotta is a great middleweight boxer, but he for some reason decides to stop boxing to go play minor league baseball in North Carolina.
Two great films, I've heard. Raging Bull Durham. I haven't seen either. That should be my next, you know.
I got Raging Bull for you if you want it.
Yeah, that should be my next, like, double pairing.
Yeah, we also put Raging Bull Durham. Absolutely.
Yep, that is correct. It is Raging Bull Durham. At number 9, we have Jim Carrey stars as an orphan teenage high schooler from Queens who is balancing his life between fighting crime and being a struggling performer whose act fails in nightclubs due to not telling conventional jokes.
We said Spider-Man on the Moon.
We also said Spider-Man on the Moon.
Yep, correct answer there being Spider-Man on the Moon.
I think that one's coming in like... The sixth installment of the MCU's.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. That'll be
like
that'll
phase
come to
six,
fruition.
Yeah.
At number 10, a small town in Texas obsesses over their high school football team. After receiving a fortune cookie, star running back Boobie Miles and coach Gary Gaines switch bodies where they develop a respect for each other and in the other members of the team.
This one actually sounds like a pretty good movie. We said Freaky Friday Night Lights.
This sounds like a really good movie until star running back tries to sleep with the coach's wife now that he's in his body. We also said Freaky Friday Night Lights.
And the correct answer is Freaky Friday Night Lights.
After the swing round, it looks like Big Spee's energy going to be picking up 35 points, bringing their total to a clean 100. And Val Kilmer's bat nips picking up 45 points, bringing their total to 120.
You know what the real treat of seeing Batman Forever in the theater was? We get Nicole Kidman before the movie and during the movie.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah.
And then you
I was like, oh, this is the first time she's actually in the movie.
And then you went home and you popped down the hours just to close out the night.
That's right. Yeah. I was asleep in moments.
All right. Well, 120 to 100. Still a very close game. David, take away round 2.
Yeah, in round 2, I said earlier, just like the first round, there is a connection with all the answers. You guys are probably to get it just as fast as you did the first one. So... Question number 1. The category is going to be history. Finished in 280 BC, this 7 wonder of the ancient world was the tallest statue in the ancient world at 33 meters or 108 feet.
Any idea, Adam?
Oh, yeah. It's going to be the Colossus at Rhodes. But, you know, there's my thought on... Yeah, we'll see if that... I think it's going to be the Colossus at Rhodes.
Okay.
Yep, we also said Colossus at Rhodes.
Yep, and the answer is Colossus of Rhodes. Number 2, the category is going to be movies. This 2017 retelling includes the people behind Olaf, Obi-Wan Kenobi, Magneto, and Caesar Flickerman.
All right, going back to the first round, it looks like we're locked in.
As soon as he said Olaf and Gandalf, I knew this was Beauty and the Beast.
Yep, we also said Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah, 2017's retelling of Beauty and the Beast. Got the clues there, Olaf, Josh Gad, Ewan McGregor, Obi-Wan Kenobi, Sir Ian McKellen as Magneto, and then Stanley Tucci as Caesar Flickerman from The Hunger Games.
Hmm. That was the odd man out there. I did not recognize that name.
And remember, there is a theme in the second round, just like the first round.
Yep. I think we got it.
Yeah, we did too.
Oh, mm-hmm. All right.
So hopefully that bodes well.
Number three, women's sports is the category for this one. This WNBA team is one of the rare teams where there is no NBA team in their city. This WNBA team won their last WNBA championship in 2020. For a little hint, usually a foul is bad in basketball, but this person, whose name sounds kind of foul, is their best player of all time.
All right, Jeff and I labored on this one for a while, making lists, checking it twice, and we're locked in with an answer that fits both categories.
Okay. Yeah, I think we have something that fits the connection, but I'm curious how lenient David will be in if we just say the team name, or do you need the city as well as part of the team name?
If you give me the team name, I'll count that as well.
Okay, cool. Because I'm hesitant on the team, but I do think there is a team, WNBA team, called the Storm. It might be the Seattle Storm. I don't know. Officially, we will just say, because there's no Seattle Seahawks, or sorry, no Seattle Supersonics anymore. So yeah, let's go with, we're just going to say the Storm.
Yeah, we said the Seattle Storm.
Yep, clue being Sue Bird, one of the best players to come out of there, and obviously Supersonics are now the Oklahoma City Thunder. The answer is the Seattle Storm. I'd be interested to see how easy these next questions are, considering it looks like you guys, again, I thought you guys would. We got on the the hints already. Number four, another movies question. I apologize for all these movies questions. I just like movies. movie in the Star Wars franchise was released in 2016, taking place between the events of The Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope.
We're locked in.
I already sent this one to John in the chat. I called it. This is going to be, he's going to ask a question about this.
I'm waiting for the culinary question about Cherry's Jubilee. We said Rogue One.
Yeah, we also said Rogue One.
Yep, answer is Rogue One. Number five, geography. Interstate 10 runs from my birth town of Jacksonville, Florida, all the way to the Santa Monica Pier in California. It goes through many big southern cities, including what capital city, home of four major sports teams? Wait, no, three. Not a big hockey town, I guess.
They just recently, fairly recently, lost the Coyotes. John, I'm pretty sure this would be Phoenix. But
yeah, okay.
Yeah, said Phoenix. Good. Congratulations to the Utah Hockey Club or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was really hoping for the Storm and Mormons, but I don't think they're ever going to do that.
They knew it was coming. They knew it was coming for years, and they couldn't come up with a name in time for the season.
I think Soakers was a possibility, but they said no.
Soakers.
That was just internet trolls.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the answer is the Phoenix, Arizona. Obviously being one of the big capital cities down there in the South.
After five questions in the second round, both teams batting perfect, picking up 50 points. That would mean that the Big Spies Energy team is at 150, and Val Kilmer's Bat Nips is at 170.
Number six, TV shows and novels. Again, this 2020 Netflix show was adapted from a 1983 novel by Walter Tevis. And a fun fact, in 2007, Elliot Page and Heath Ledger was set to work on a movie about this book that would later turn into the show.
Okay, we are locked in on this one.
All right, Adam, I'm not 100% on that, but I think it checks all the boxes on it.
Mm-hmm.
So do you have anything else?
No. I mean, I
because I know it's on Netflix. I know it's a popular show. Yeah, and I'm pretty sure it's based on a book. And it's right around that time. So
yeah, I'm good with that.
We're going to go with Queen's Gambit.
We also said Queen's Gambit.
Correct. Answer is Queen's Gambit. All right. Number seven is in food. I may have tipped my hat, I guess. This dessert dish is made with a fruit from an alleged presidential tail and liqueur, which are flambéed tableside and commonly served as a sauce over vanilla ice cream.
We're locked in.
Well, I guess we know the answer is Cherry's Jubilee.
Yeah.
Sure. Yep, we all said Cherry's Jubilee.
Yep, yep, and that is Cherry's Jubilee.
I mean, where else are you going to get that one in? That's the only option.
How dare you?
I actually thought he might ask a question about the Queen's Jubilee.
Yep. Yeah.
In England.
The Golden Jubilee, possibly. The Diamond Jubilee.
Yeah.
All right, number 8. This is in companies. Headquartered in North Bethesda, Maryland, in the D.C. area, this company is an American defense manufacturer and was founded on March 15th, 1995.
Okay, the other guys are locked in. We're having trouble. I compiled a pretty good list of things that would fit the category. We can't work one of them in, so we can't get it that way. We're just going to guess a defense contractor and say Lockheed Martin and hope for the best.
All right, so Kitty Pride is, I'm just going to talk about Kitty Pride for no reason. She had a wonderful little purple dragon at her side in much of the comic books, has not been in any of the films or anything, and that dragon's name is Lockheed.
Oof,
so
wow.
We also said Lockheed Martin.
Yeah, good pull. You can pull out your ass, you can pull out anywhere you want, but the correct answer is Lockheed Martin.
Of the three defense contractors that we could think of, that was definitely one of them.
And I think, so they've been around, both companies I think have been around longer, but they've only been Lockheed Martin since then.
Yeah, we also thought of Raytheon and Northrop Grumman, but
they started
the one that seemed like it was going to fit the best was Lockheed Martin.
They started as Lockheed Martin Lewis, but then Jerry Lewis left.
I see.
And now it's just Lockheed Martin.
And McGlavin.
Yeah, number 9. This one is in musicians. This American singer-songwriter, who passed away in October of 2017, was one of the early pioneers of rock and roll. Elvis Presley once even described him as the real king of rock and roll, and he had such songs as Ain't That a Shame and Blueberry Hill.
Oh.
Yeah.
Adam.
Yeah.
Got it.
All right, these guys are locked in. I'm not 100% sure. We think Chuck Berry died later. It doesn't really fit the category. I can't really pull a specific name, but we're going to say the last name is Bishop.
I found my thrill on Blueberry Hill. This is one of my favorite singers from that era. This is Fats Domino.
Yep. Correct answer is Fats
Domino. That was a lucky, very lucky, lucky pull there.
Uh-huh.
All right, yeah. Number 10. This is going to be in the category of transportation. Though the earliest model of these were made in London, England in 1840, the first one of these in America was the West Side and Yonkers Patent Railway in New York City in 1868. If you haven't gotten the answers by now, these clues may be going over your head.
So I got a couple different names here. Cyclops, Nightcrawler, Jean Grey, Bishop, Cable Car. That's it.
So if you haven't figured out the theme yet, maybe consider that. We went with Cable Car as well.
Yeah, answer is Cable Car. The hint there was the song Over My Head, which is also called Cable Car.
And the bonus, of course, we think everybody's caught on so far, is the X-Men. So both teams are getting 5 points for that. And what are the scores total?
So after the second round, Bixby's Energy is going to be at 205, and Val Kilmer's Batnips is going to be at 215. So all that separates the teams is 10 points, which makes all the wagering coming up soon very important. Before we get to that, though, just wanted to say that, we talked about Patreon before, but we're making a serious push to get to 1,000 patrons, which means we can do this full time. So if you'd like to join all the wonderful folks out there who are listening to all of our bonus content on patreon.com/trivialitypodcast, including David and so many others, you can listen to hours and hours of bonus content, weekly trivia bonuses, or for as little as $1 a month. Just get all of our episodes ad-free, which I know some of you don't like hearing the ads, but that's what the Patreon's for. So come join us at patreon.com/trivialitypodcast to help us get to 1,000 patrons and full-time work.
Yeah, so the overall category is going to be not quite sports. I know not people are huge sports fans. The subcategories for that, question one is celebrity couples. Question number two is actors. Question number three, alcoholic beverages. Question number four, history. And question number five, video games.
All right. Both teams decided, since this is just a game for fun and the only thing on the line is being the cream of the crop, we got nothing to lose. So both teams are going 30s all the way down. let's have the questions and see who will be today's cream of the crop.
Question number one, in the category of celebrity couples. In 2007, Tony Romo dated which singer who was scrutinized and blamed for Tony Romo's lack of performance, always attending his games in a pink Romo jersey and cut-off jean shorts? Question number two, in the category of actors. This actor's dad was actually the commissioner who banned Pete Rose from baseball. You may know him from his roles in San Andreas and Straight Outta Compton. Question number three, in alcoholic beverages. What popular brand of whiskey launched in 2018 by Stephen and Brittany Yang is an unexpected mix of smooth whiskey that tastes like peanut butter, and I truthfully do not know how they pitched that one. Question number four, in the category of history. In 1963, Hall of Fame pitcher Gaylord Perry once said, "They'll do what before I hit a home run?" 6 years later, he hit the first and only home run a mere six after this event occurred. What did he say would happen before he hit a home run? Question number five, in the category of video games. This video game is the highest selling game on the Wii console with 82.90 million copies sold. This is a whopping 45.52 million copies more than the second place game, which had only 27.38 million copies.
We now have the final round questions. We'll be back to see who will be today's cream of the crop. Oh yeah.
This episode is brought to you by State Farm. You might say all kinds of stuff when things go wrong, but these are the words you really need to remember. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. They've got options to fit your unique insurance needs, meaning you can talk to your agent to choose the coverage you need, have coverage options to protect the things you value most, file a claim right on the State Farm mobile app, and even reach a real person when you need to talk to someone. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Listen in. Starbucks. It's a great day for coffee.
If you're listening to this podcast, then we know you love learning. So let me tell you about Airwave History Plus, now available on Apple Podcasts. Airwave History Plus is your ticket to ad-free listening, bonus content, and early episodes from dozens of the most popular history podcasts, including History That Doesn't Suck, The Explorers Podcast, The History of World War II, Queen's Podcast, The History of Egypt, The Age of Napoleon, and more. For your free trial, search Airwave History Plus on Apple Podcasts and hit subscribe. That's Airwave History Plus, available now on Apple Podcasts. Airwave History Plus, the essential audio destination for history lovers.
All the answers are now locked in. We are ready to hear these questions one more time and see who will take the championship today. Will it be the Speas brothers, the tag team champions? Or will it be Val Kilmer's Batnips? Slightly less regal, but... Let's hear it, David.
Certainly on point.
Certainly on point. Actually, they're kind of flat in Batman Forever. They're a little more pointed in Batman and Robin. Isn't that right, Neil?
That is correct. Yeah, George Clooney's are a lot pointier.
Here's the thing. I don't understand why there were Batnips at all, because at the end of Batman Forever, when he tries out his new suit does not have Batnips.
Correct.
That could have just been the suit the whole time. Solved the problem.
Who knows what they were thinking? David?
Get Joel Schumacher on the phone.
Yeah. We'll get him.
He's passed away.
We'll get him.
All right. Question number one. In 2007, Tony Romo dated which singer who was scrutinized and blamed for Tony Romo's lack of performance, always attending his games in pink Romo jerseys and cutoff jean shorts?
I hate this whole thing. Just blame him for sucking. It's not anybody else's problem.
It's certainly not Jessica Simpson's problem, but that's what we said.
Yeah, I also had a connection and kind of remembered that. Doesn't matter if she knows if Chicken of the Sea is chicken or tuna, but I do know she looked good in her pink Tony Romo jersey and her jean shorts, so we also went with Jessica Simpson.
Yeah, answer is Jessica Simpson. I guess you could also call those jean shorts just Daisy Dukes if you wanted. Question number two. Actors. This actor's dad was actually the commissioner who banned Pete Rose from playing baseball. You may know him from his roles in movies such as San Andreas and Straight Outta Compton.
Well, I love this so much.
We're stupid.
Because Ken remembered an actor who's in both of them.
Yeah, here's a man who is a great, great performer. But and he's also not above like taking kind of a little fun role like San Andreas.
And there's only one thing we would typecast this person's father as, and it's baseball commissioner.
And we said Paul Giamatti.
Yeah. We couldn't come up with anything, and apparently neither of us read the question carefully enough, because the only actor I could remember from any other either of them was Alexander Daddario, so that's what we came up with.
Yeah, I guess I could have put, you know, everybody's favorite movie, Big Fat Liar, with Frankie Muniz in there too. But yeah, Paul Giamatti, whose dad was the seventh commissioner of baseball, A. Bartlett Giamatti.
Can't you just picture Paul Giamatti playing a baseball commissioner, though?
Right,
like,
right.
That's where it mostly came from.
Question number three, what popular brand of whiskey launched in 2018 by Stephen and Brittany Yang is an unexpected mix of smooth whiskey that tastes like peanut butter, and I truthfully don't know how they pitched this whiskey.
Well, Jeff coming in at the last minute.
No, that was a team effort. You said pitched, and I threw it right over the plate.
Yeah, and I mean, yeah, you were clutch here. You said screwball.
Yep. Yeah, it fits with all the stuff. I have owned this liqueur before, and it is sweet and tasty and a hint of peanut butter, and I just kind of knew and eventually got it. It is screwball.
Yeah, but I left this screwball hanging over the plate. Like, just like this entire round, it seems like getting knocked out of the park, but the answer is screwball. Question number four in history. In 1963, Hall of Fame pitcher Gaylord Perry once said, "They'll do what before I hit a home run?" 6 years later, he hit the first and only home run a mere 6 hours after what events that he said would happen before he hit his first home run.
Yeah, didn't know that this movie was going to come up twice in this episode, but we said Man on the Moon.
Adam, you came up with this one.
Oh, sure. Yeah, yeah. We didn't say exactly put a man on. We said they'll walk on the moon before we do it. So we had similar but slightly different. I don't know how specific you want to be.
Nah, I'll give both of you that points. Same thing. Put a man on the moon. First man to walk on the moon. Yeah, he said that would be the first thing to happen before he hit a home run, and it did on the exact same day. Question number five, the final question in the category of video games. This video game is the highest selling game on the Wii console with 82.90 million copies sold. This is a whopping 45.52 million copies, more than the second place game, which had 27.38 million copies sold as well.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba. We said Wii Sports.
Yeah, I have this. I still have this console. I still use this console on occasion, and we only have a few games, and one of them is definitely Wii Sports, and that's what we put.
Yep, correct answer is Wii Sports. It definitely helped that the console was bundled with this game as well. The second highest one was actually Mario Kart Wii, just for a little factoid in there as well.
After that amazing final round from David, the scores are in, and it was very close going into the final round. Only 10 points separated both teams. Big Spee's Energy only missed one question in the final round after wagering everything. That will bring their total to 295, but it was just one question that changed the game, because Val Kilmer's Bat Nips got all of their questions right, picking up 150 points, bringing their total to 365. Making them today's cream of the crop, and proving that we have enough episodes to listen to Triviality every day of the year.
All day.
That's right.
Well done.
You're a winner, baby.
Good job. Great game, both of you. I was very, very close the entire game. It was only 10-point difference there until the final. Now, Adam and John, it was a pleasure having you on the show. We love listening to your show. Where can people find you, and any other shout-outs before we let you go today?
Yeah, you guys can find us on pretty much any podcast platform, Throwback Trivia Takedown. If you guys like pop culture and nostalgic based trivia shows, go at least go back and listen to the one that Neil was on. We'll definitely have to get Jeff and Ken in there as well. So yeah, we have a lot of good times on Throwback Trivia Takedown. Make sure you guys check that out, and or go to beefupnetwork.com and listen to any of our other shows that we've got. BFOPnetwork.com.
And if you're interested in being in the patron tournament, you can go to bfopnetwork.com to find a link to our Patreon and join at the $5 level or more.
Awesome. It's always great to support shows. And David, you're a patron, speaking of that, and we appreciate that and thank you for it. So great to have you here today with your awesome game. Anyone you'd like to shout out or anything you'd like to say before we let you go today?
Yeah, I guess a little shout out. Thanks to my wife for letting me wake her up at 6 o'clock in the morning to drive back from Tampa. Thanks to my dogs, Harper and Utley, for staying quiet the entire time. And a little shout out to David, Pokemon Master, Kristen, Anthony, and Luna in the Discord for helping me play test these. A lot of great feedback that came back with that. First time writing a game for you guys. I just thought it was, sometimes you think it's just as easy as putting questions in there, but sometimes you got to think, you know, who's the audience, you know, how it's going to read when you get to the game. And they certainly did help a lot when it came to that. So I'd like to thank them for that. And then I guess final words of wisdom. I don't know if you guys can cut that out, but final words of wisdom. It's close to voting time, so just register to vote. Doesn't matter who you vote for, just let your voice be heard.
Great advice.
Great advice. And speaking of the great network of people that helped you, all of our play testers, we have a great network to shout out, Ken.
That's right. We are proud to be part of Airwave Media. You can find them at airwavemedia.com. Check out other great podcasts such as Engadget Morning Edition, The Dallas Morning News is part of Airwave Media, and how about Calm History? Just want a little calm history.
It's all the history that maybe didn't make the textbooks, but you know, when Benjamin Franklin walked down a lane and looked at a tree.
Very,
very calm.
Yes.
Well, yeah, we'd love for you to check those shows out. But for all of us here, Matt's getting soaked right now. Well, hopefully he's doing okay. But for Ken, Jeff, Adam, John, and David, my name is Neil, and we'll see you next week on another episode, Triviality.